This is my fourth time in Hiroshima. Every time you come here to this city, it's very important because this is a symbol, this is a sign of our fight for a nuclear-free world.
I'm happy to see that IPPNW has accomplished a great deal, and the world has recognized its contribution, most notably with the Nobel Peace Prize in 1985. You have changed the thinking of the world and greatly advanced the cause toward creating a world without nuclear weapons by reshaping this movement to represent the true wishes of the citizens of the world, including the Hiroshima.
I'm in Hiroshima after my first visit 23 years ago for the 9th World Congress of IPPNW, where I first got committed to this cause. Being in Hiroshima was a very profound experience for me as a young person, and being exposed to the work that doctors were doing to try to address the medical consequences of nuclear war seemed like a very powerful approach to me. And so I've been continuously involved with IPPNW and this cause ever since, and being here in Hiroshima again 23 years later as a older person reaffirms my belief that this is the issue that we all need to be working on to save humankind.
And so this year, for the first time, we were able to study what actually happens to food production under these conditions. And what we found is very disturbing. With support for this discovery, we looked at the production of corn, maize, as it's called in the rest of the world outside of the United States, in the U.S., which is the world's largest producer of maize, and rice production in China, the world's largest producer of rice. This graph shows, well, that basically, that U.S. corn production would decline about 12%, and this decline would last, on average, that is, this would last for a full decade, for 10 years. The decline would not be even over time. It would peak in the fifth year, when U.S. corn production would be down by a full 20%. Similarly, in China, rice production, averaged over 10 years, would go down by about 15%. Again, over time, it's not even, in the case of Chinese rice production, the declines are most intense in the first few years, as much as 25 to 30% in the second year after the war. World grain reserves amount to only about 60 or 70 days of consumption. And there are already a very large number of people who at baseline are severely malnourished. The consensus is that it takes about 1,800 to 2,000 calories a day to support an adult human being, allow them to maintain their body mass, and to do a little bit of work. There are in the world today 925 million people who do not meet these minimum requirements. That as many as 1 billion people would be at risk of death by starvation in the event of a war limited to South Asia. Many of these fatalities would take place in South Asia, many more would take place in other parts of Asia, in Latin America, and especially in Africa. And the import of these findings, I think, is enormous. They require that we make a fundamental change in the way we think about nuclear weapons. We have now to understand that it is not just the arsenals of the US and Russia that pose a global threat, but also the arsenals of developing nuclear powers, like India and Pakistan, or Israel, or the other smaller nuclear weapon states, that pose a threat to all of humanity.
I would like to give some brief background on why the Red Cross and Red Crescent movement chose this time to speak out louder than ever on this topic. To be part of the urgency of finding a diplomatic, political, or legal solution to the existence of nuclear weapons. We all know that there is a medical and humanitarian response, potentially not, to the use of these weapons. But the answer to their eradication lies in society, in law, in politics, and in enthusiasm to push those in a position of power to do something. For far too long, this debate has been located in power politics and military doctrine, and the movement was very, very clear that we want to help reframe the debate about people. And finally, the resolution was created to support and encourage those national societies, the Red Cross and Red Crescent, that are able and willing to work hard towards a nuclear-free world.
I'm Kati Juva from Finland, and I have been active in IPPNW for nearly 30 years, and although we still have many nuclear weapons around, I think one thing we have achieved that the nuclear war hasn't come yet, and we are going to prevent it forever. So that's why I'm here.
Human activity is threatening the environment, the environmental integrity of our planet, and human survival. Unfettered economic development and unsustainable living patterns are causing irreversible climate change, while growing militarism and the militarization of diplomacy threaten the catastrophic use of nuclear weapons by design or by accident. The 20th World Congress in Japan in 2012 does carry, I think, a special significance. The atomic bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki and the nuclear reactor meltdown in Fukushima in 2011, last year, I think have conferred on Japan a unique status. The only nation in the world to have been struck by what I would call the curse of nuclear fission on two separate occasions. And the people of Japan well know that it is time to abolish nuclear weapons and to phase out nuclear power.
Making a distinction between nuclear energy and nuclear weapons is a trap. The 1970 non-proliferation treaty from 1970 is the cornerstone of the global nuclear non-proliferation regime. The treaty has three important aspects. The most important one, and that's why we join as IPPNW, the nuclear weapon states have an obligation not to only reduce their nuclear arsenals, but to eventually abolish them. Second, the overwhelming majority of the non-nuclear weapon states, such as Japan, promise not to acquire nuclear weapons. And the third one, Article 4 of the NPT affirms that all state parties to the treaty in good standing have a right to benefit from the so-called peaceful use of the atom. It further commits the parties to cooperate with one another in the fullest possible exchange of nuclear equipment, materials, and information for peaceful, in quotation marks, purposes. This is tragic because this system provides a concrete blueprint for the expansion of nuclear energy worldwide, even with the help of the IAEA, the International Atomic Energy Agency.
The concept of a nuclear chain basically states that a nuclear weapon is not an item that exists by itself. There's a process to that nuclear weapon, and there's also a process after the deployment of a nuclear weapon in an arsenal. In order to make a nuclear weapon, a country has to get uranium from the ground. Uranium mining is the first step to getting a nuclear weapon. That country has to transport this uranium to an enrichment facility. It has to be enriched, then it has to be turned into a weapon, it has to be deployed, the country's tested these nuclear weapons for many, many years. And after the nuclear weapon is not being needed or not being used, it's disarmed, it is turned into nuclear waste. And surprisingly enough, for many people, this is the same process as nuclear energy. which also requires uranium mining and enrichment and transportation of radioactive products, which also creates nuclear waste. And we, as IPPNW doctors and medical students, took this concept a little further and said, it's not just the people who suffered from nuclear bombs, but also the people who suffered from nuclear accidents, from uranium mining, from nuclear waste, from accidents of nuclear power plants. All of these people suffer because of this nuclear chain. So people all over the world, in Canada, the US, and Australia, in Gabun, and in Kyrgyzstan, they are, in fact, also victims of the production of nuclear weapons. They are also Hibakusha.
This Congress is very important because it's in a historical place. Their first explosion of atomic bomb was against the peace population, so it must never happen again, so we will try to do this.
Generation that makes you start from here to into the future. Whilst we may not do anything about the past, surely we can modify the future, we can reinvent the future, we can make the future, we can even change the future. Maybe we may not do much about climate change now, but surely we can change the paradigm about the nuclear issue. So I start from that premise. And if you have your folder there, there's a Zambian proverb, very, very succinct, very, very appropriate for a meeting such as this one. It says that growing trees are the next forest. So without growing trees, there will be no forest. And here we are in this meeting, and in IPPNW, and I speak for the Federation in that respect, that the youth, the student members, are the lifeblood of this organization.
I would recommend students who are interested to participate in these kind of dialogues with decision makers, because it's really important for them to know that students are involved in these issues and are interested to know what the decision makers' policies are and how to interact with them. And well, use the help of the younger generation.
My name is Bob Mutonga, currently one of the co-presidents of IPPNW. I'm from Zambia. I'm here in Hiroshima to get energized, as well as energize others, as we move the IPPNW programs along, dubbed from Hiroshima to Generations Future. That's my aim. That is why I'm here.
So this is very much an IPPNW campaign, but it also extends beyond IPPNW to include a whole lot of other groups. Our basic goal is a treaty to ban nuclear weapons. So we've got treaties banning chemical weapons, biological weapons, cluster munitions, landmines. We think it's long overdue to get negotiations underway on a nuclear weapons ban. 146, so roughly 3 in 4 countries, have said that they want negotiations to begin on the nuclear weapons treaty. 22 think it's a little bit too soon. Most of these countries are US allies, which could have something to do with it. And 26 against. They've said, no way, don't even talk about it. So our challenge, everyone in this room, if your country is one of the countries that supports a nuclear weapons convention, what's your country going to do to make this happen? So we need to turn the passive support of these countries into really active support. So we want these countries to drive the process for a nuclear weapons ban. If your country's on the fence, make sure that they go the right side of the fence, not the wrong side, and don't give up on the ones that are in the don't support
category. We just need to be really persistent. But I think that if we put enough pressure on these nuclear weapon states from other countries, that's how we can achieve our goal of a nuclear weapon-free world, because we can't just leave it to the nuclear weapon states to decide when and how many nuclear weapons they get rid of.
And I think the doctors can bring a lot and really be the spin of this movement to promote shifts toward a more humanitarian-based concern.
Strong economies and not nuclear weapons convey prestige, influence, security, power, and even deterrence using different means. And we have to change our assumptions and our expectations. You know, a ban on nuclear weapons is not going to solve all the world's problems overnight. It isn't going to solve all the world's conflict. What it will do is make it far less likely that conflict will result in the use of nuclear weapons. But we have to understand that making the world nuclear free would make sure that even if one nuclear weapon were ever used, it could not turn into a global catastrophe. We have to delegitimize and develop deterrence. We have to shift from this nuclear weapon-centered arms control to the international ban-centered discourse you heard very strongly from Dr. McCoy about the kind of philosophical as well as practical underpinnings of it. We're saying that a nuclear weapon ban treaty is a game changer. We're moving away from the idea that it has to be incredibly technically complicated with all accounting rules and verification. That has to be done by the nuclear armed states. But the treaty that would be the game changer would be one that the non-nuclear weapon states could push for, could lead, which would change the law. So we see the nuclear ban treaty, the nuclear weapon convention, nuclear abolition treaty, doesn't matter what you call it, it's what it does that matters. Not as the last step in the process, but as the next step. Not the complete solution, but creating political legal context for elimination and eradication of nuclear weapons. And because we see it in that way, we think it can be achieved actually rather quickly, because it's a political legal enterprise.
My opinion is, together with the other IPPNW colleagues, have a vote, rule of peace and security for all the people. And I would like to change my friend during this conference about my country, because we have very peaceful people and they never think about nuclear bomb or war. And we would like to have a peaceful relation with all the countries around the world.